So, yeah, obviously, the reason I thought I'd get you on the call is because I spoke to you for Radio Times briefly.
Yes, it was a lovely piece. Thank you for that.
You're very welcome. Thank you for doing it. But we had about a minute where we could talk about old school Neighbours.
Yes.
And there was quite a lot of fun stories that you had about it. And that was only in the 1 minute. So I was like, we must talk about more old school Neighbours. So here we are. And we got there in the end. Long time in the works, this interview.
Yes. Well, you know, there has been some things to come along the way that have sort of steered things off course a trifle.
Oh, I mean, that just sums up the last 2 years of life in general, doesn't it?
Doesn't it? It sort of does, doesn't it? It's just been a bit of dealing with one, you know, bizarre thing from another bizarre thing. That's kind of how I
We must be due for the calm now. We've had the storm for such a long time. We must be due for it. So let's go back to 1987.
Oh, my Lord. That really is going back. That must be the first, okay? The first
time. I believe it was. So you came in as Henry's girlfriend, didn't you, back in 87 as a guest role?
Yes.
To what Paul tells me, Jason Donovan said was his favourite ever scene in the show was the scene of you in there doing a laugh and everything. Like, what was that like coming into the show at that point? Because it was pretty big then, wasn't it?
Well, it wasn't in Australia at that point, if you know what I mean. It wasn't really, and it hadn't really, it was starting to take off. It was starting to happen. People were starting to notice it in the UK. Much more at that stage.
Hey everyone, this is Melanie. My sister Charlene, her husband Scott, and that's Mum.
You all live in the same house together? Gee.
Well, it's all right. We've got pretty thick walls here.
Oh, Henry, thick walls!
So, yes, so, you know, that was just before Kylie released Locomotion. So it was before that sort of thing had started there of people, you know, releasing records and, you know, going over to the UK, if you know what I mean. So it was sort of around that time. So, yes, it was an exciting time. And it was so much fun because I had this trick to go in and do, this stupid laugh that I had done at the audition and that had cracked everybody up and had got me the job.
Was there always supposed to be a laugh? Was that
that's all the character was in the beginning. They just wanted someone who could do like a really ridiculous laugh that everyone would have to react to, if you know what I mean, and it would just be horrendous and oh my God, what do you do with someone like this? You know, it was, you know, she was the worst. You know, she was like the nobody liked her as Henry's girlfriend. Nobody wanted her to be Henry's girlfriend except for Henry, only momentarily. But yeah, so, you know, she was a disaster pretty much on two legs, is kind of, you know, that was super embarrassing.
Lucinda, I know that's not your real laugh. But where did it come from? Because it's pretty unique.
What I was given at the audition, what they said, it was a cross between a seal honking and a donkey braying was what they asked for.
Okay.
I had to go back to those sort of, you know, the workshops you do at drama school about being an animal and stuff and the kind of person that's a bit like a donkey, or if you know what I mean. So she kind of like was a bit like a, you know.
Do you feel that you've refined the laugh over all these years?
It was a bit hard to do at first when I first started back, because it had, you know, it had been a fair while since I'd done it, I must admit. Although, you know, people used to try to corner me in, you know, places when I was still living in the UK in Tesco's and stuff and try to get me to do it for them.
Yeah, I apologise for that. Sorry.
I apologise if I didn't do it, Paul, because often I just, you know, said some expletives to people because I was, you know, having a bad day in the shop, which, you know, isn't the best way to be.
And you mentioned going back. Obviously, we said that they're all here. We can't really talk too much about the present show, except to say that Melanie and Toadie, absolute dream, keep it together. But what was it like for you coming back into the show sort of as try and find Melanie again after all this time. It had been quite a while.
It was so easy. It was ridiculously easy. And the reason why it was so easy was because it was so well written. And it was like they hadn't missed a beat, if you know what I mean. It was like it was really well written. And as soon as I read it, I knew exactly how she would say everything that she had to say. If you know, it was so lovely to be her again. And because I never expected to be, you know?
Yeah. It's and, really good they have.
And she was so much fun. And so, yeah, and it had been, you know, seriously, 87. And I think I left at the end of 1991
mm-hmm.
Over here, which I think at that time you guys were about 2 years behind.
Yeah, it was about 18.
At that time. So, which worked really well for us as actors because we could leave the show and then come over and hang out with you guys for a couple of years until you got sick of us. For me, I stayed way too long. I stayed 17 years and you did really get sick of me. So it's good that I came home.
You are right as well that they've got Melanie to a T now. Like, it is the same character because that doesn't always happen. Like, Joe Mangle's character, for example, was ruined when he came back.
Yes. No, that wasn't good. But I just think I don't know how they did it. It was when I read it, I was like, oh my God, I just knew it wasn't like, oh God, how do we find the gear for Melanie? If you know what I mean. It was sort of, it was like, it wasn't about the laugh. It was about her like little shiny brightness that she has, you know.
It feels like it is where it can be.
Yeah.
The sort of things you've been doing. Was it strange to read the script and be seeing things like sort of Sky and Toby mentioned, or Madame Zolga and things? Were you like, wow, I feel like I'm literally stepping back in time?
Yes, it did feel like stepping back in time, but it was stepping back in time, and everything was different.
It's
a bit of a mind melt, and it's funny. Because it's really, there are things that are exactly the same, but there are things like I'm at the Rebecca house, which used to be the Mangle house.
Yeah, it was Dorothy Burke's, wasn't it, that one?
It was Dorothy Burke's. It wasn't Dorothy Burke's.
Wasn't it?
It wasn't Dorothy Burke's. Dorothy Burke's was number 30, I think.
Yeah, that's the Rebecca house.
That's oh God, I'm so confused. this happens all the time, and because they're in impossible to see the insides, whether that's the same, it feels like the same house to me.
And they're totally different as well now. Like most of them look
and
so
it used
different.
To be, yeah. The Kennedy house is, you know, what I knew as the Willis house.
Yeah.
And before that, the Clark house that I lived in as well. And it's very weird because you go back into these houses and you don't say anything about the fact that you used to live there.
I always find that odd. I'm always
it's really strange. Why do they do that? Because it would be like, oh my God, I used to live in this house.
Yeah, it's like you've got Jane living in Charlene's old house now, and I don't even think that's
been there,
but it's like, come on, they would be. So to go back again, so you were on as a guest, weren't you, originally? And then
yes, originally I came in for just but a little blip. Yes.
And then there were a few more good blips. In sort of the couple of years after that, were you starting to get the sense of, okay, I might be quite a popular character here with the fans because they kept bringing you back? And were you expecting to land the job full time like you did?
No, it was very weird because what happened was I did another show in between a really terrible daytime soap. That was exactly. Called the Power and the Passion.
All right, going to be looking for that.
Oh my God, I don't know whether you'll even find anything except the opening title. You might find the opening titles of it somewhere. It was like really bad. We shot it almost live.
Oh wow.
It was really mental. We shot it consecutively. It was like it moved from each set. It was the weirdest thing. And I did that in between guesting, and I only did I did a guest at the beginning, and then they asked me back like as a guest, but then they asked me to stay the second time. So, and that was because I'd got the sack from The Power and the Passion.
Which worked out quite well.
So it worked out quite well. And one of the girls that worked on the show, one of the director's assistants, had said, you know, you should contact Mark Callan because, you know, they really liked you on Neighbours. And I was like, oh, do you think? And she was like, yeah, look, Mark Callan's a really good friend of mine. Do you want me to ring him for you? And she actually rang him for me and said, Lucinda's just been let go from Power and the Passion. And we thought maybe, you know, blah, blah, blah. And he was like, oh, send her in. And then it went from there.
That's amazing because I'm watching Neighbours from the beginning at the moment while I'm working. It's kind of like my background noise, even though I spend much time working. But
We're like your wallpaper.
Really entertaining wallpaper that I love. But it's got to the point now where you've just you've come back in. You were living with Sally, I think, for a while, and now you've disappeared again. But it's very much like how Chris Milligan's joined the show as Carl. It's like you were there, kind of
Sally. For a while. Was that Rowena Moore?
Paul, you know the answer for that.
It was, yeah, Rowena Moore. Yeah.
Oh my God! Wow. Yeah, I haven't thought of her for a long time. She was a lovely girl.
It's great dynamic between the two of you as well with the Henry rivalry. So you came back onto the show, and obviously this is normally in these interviews we try and go through all of the big sort of Melanie moments, but we've only got sort of 15 minutes left, so I thought it'd be good to kind of go sort of from your highlight memories, but obviously we'll pick a couple ourselves as well. But you mentioned in the Radio Times interview that you were very good friends with Reverend Richards, was it?
Yes, Anthony Fletcher, who is still one of my very best friends in the world. Yes, we met on the show and we were like kindred spirits, and he played the Reverend Richards, and I remember having to be it was kind of like, I think he kind of fancied Melanie, but he sort of didn't know whether he was kind of supposed to or allowed to be, or you know, it was really gorgeous,
very awkward kisses. I remember,
yes, there was at the drive-in. Was it the drive-in? I think it was at the drive-in. I think we went to the drive-in.
It was,
with,
yeah.
Ashley Paskey, I think Ashley was there, who played Matt. And yes. I think maybe Jessica Musker. I think it's Sharon.
Yeah, played Sharon,
yes,
Davies.
Sharon. I couldn't remember. I couldn't remember her character's name. Yes. Yeah, so I think there was some sort of double date thing and it didn't go well.
Popcorn, anyone?
No, not for me, thanks. Sorry. Come on, it's fine. It's just a film. Nothing to be frightened of.
But they remained very good friends, just like we did.
Just like in real life.
And there was one of my favourite scenes that I've ever done was we did karaoke and Craig was there and and Anthony Fletcher, who played the Reverend Richards, and I can't remember who else. Maybe Rachel Friend. That was one of my favourites we did. That was a funny one. Oh!
Look, I know you're a man of the cloth, but we're going to have to lie when she gets back to the table, aren't we?
Do unto others as you would have them do unto you.
But
we lie.
No, not at all. I think she's very brave.
There was also a funny cake competition one that the Reverend Richards judged, which was funny, and Melanie won with a pig cake, of course.
Of course she did. What would she know? What I think I love about Melanie the most is that she's had some sort of big storylines of her own, but she seems to come alive in other people's storylines by kind of coming in and stealing them in the best possible way. For example, Paul and Christina's wedding, which is one that nobody really remembers for Paul and Christina. They all remember for Melanie.
Yeah, and the dress switcheroo, wasn't it? Yeah, the dress. Yeah. Melanie thinks that she's left her dress, her wedding dress. So she, Yeah, so she puts on her bridesmaid's dress. Oh, does she put on the wedding dress?
I think she wears the wedding dress and runs through Melbourne.
I remember the veil and not being able to see a thing, and there being cars going past, and the veil was in my face. And yeah, no, that was hilarious. And then, of course, their honeymoon, which I ruined as well.
It was such a fun storyline. But this was must have been around the time where you decided to leave the show, I guess, because there wasn't too long in it from that to when you actually left.
No, you're right.
So I'm kind of wondering how that came about, because Melanie was still getting some really, really strong storylines and real sort of great.
Oh,
ending.
Yeah. I was a nut. I was crazy. I don't know. I sort of, you know, I hadn't really thought of it like that, if you know what I mean. I kind of felt like I'd done my time in a soap and now I needed to do something else, if you know what I mean. That's kind of how I felt. I was kind of young and ambitious and thought that, you know, there were lots of other mountains to climb, you know, and I suppose you kind of do when you're that age and you get that sort of success and you kind of go, oh, okay. And everyone was going over to the UK, so I did too. And yeah, and I had a great time over there and did lots of fun things that I'm sure that I wouldn't have had the chance of doing if I had stayed here. But, you know, I probably should have revisited Melanie earlier than I did, if you know what I mean. I think, but it's great that I have now. So, you know, in all reality, there's no point sort of, you know, having regrets about stuff like that.
Well, that's it. I mean,
but yeah, she was pretty in full flight when she left, but that's not a bad way of going at the end of the day.
And no. I ask though, because Melanie was, to me, she was two very different people. So there was the period of time that she was with Paul and Christina and Caroline and that whole kind of relationship. And then there was the whole kind of them becoming Joe's girlfriend and then wife. And she took on that role as mother. What was your favourite kind of Melanie?
I kind of preferred her when she was footloose and fancy free. I thought she was at her best when she was footloose and fancy free, really.
Yeah.
Because she could just be that crazy single friend, which is kind of, you know, I've always thought where she sits happiest, you know, she's not necessarily attached or being a bit of a love zombie, because I think she can be a bit of a love zombie.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, I think she's, you kind of get more of her when she's just being her, truly herself and not pleasing. She is a people pleaser, Melanie, definitely. Even though she kind of thinks she's not, she does care very much how people think of her.
I know they always say never work with animals and children, but you got the double whammy. So how was that working with Bouncer and obviously Miranda Fryer as Skye?
Yeah, look, I actually found it difficult. I found it difficult at that age, for her at that age, for Miranda. There were times where she wasn't happy, if you know what I mean, and it was uncomfortable. And I, you know, I just, you know, yeah, I don't know. I don't know. I feel weird about that sort of stuff, although it's so much changed now. Kids are so much better looked after now than they used to be.
Yeah,
we work, of course, with little John and Scarlett a lot with Ryan. And yeah, you know, they're really much more in control of everything than the kids were in the early days.
Yeah.
So it's interesting, towards your sort of the end of the time on the show, it's like, as Paul was saying, there were two different Melanies. And Melanie kind of, she got herself sucked into the seriousness of Joe's life quite a lot. Were you kind of disappointed that she was going out not really at her peak comedy, as she were, and she was in these more sort of Joe Mangold lost his wife, he'd run over this other person.
And she'd become, you know, stepmom and all of that sort of stuff. Yeah. I don't know. I don't think I even thought of it like that, you know. I don't think you can, I don't, when you're in the midst of something, you know, of that sort of stuff, and you're just so, you're so exhausted by it. It is, you know, pretty full on, working at the rate that you do to get this sort of soap out. It's pretty hectic. And so I don't know whether you really are really that aware of where you are in the timeline of it, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, I suppose it all kind of merges into one for you, doesn't it, I guess, when you're going through.
You're really thinking about the next thing.
That's it. And what, you know, do you, you know what I mean? Remember about sort of actually leaving? I'm sorry if you can hear a dog kicking off outside of my door at the moment.
That's all right. I've got one of those too.
Is he as mental as mine? Because my one is ridiculous. Like,
yeah, no, it's a she and she's totally mental. Yeah, oh, she's good. Okay. Hilariously mental. Yeah,
is that, yeah, that sums up Duke as well. So what do you remember about sort of as you were sort of leaving the show? Were you sad to be going at that point, or was it very much just looking towards the future?
Yeah, I think I was looking towards the future. I was looking towards the future. It was sad to leave though, because it was a really important part of, you know, of my life, and there were people there. In fact, I actually pulled something out for you because I didn't know whether it was going to be video, but I pulled out this old thing that they'd made, that was made for me when I left. Oh, and it's like a big, it's all these different pictures of me and pictures, like, you know, the continuity pictures that they have to take for your hair and makeup and all that sort of stuff. I'll take a picture of it and send it to you.
Oh, that would be amazing.
It's huge, though. It's really big, and everyone on the, has signed it on the back. And so that would be, I think my dad kept this for me in his garage while I was, you know, living the high life in London. And, yeah, and I found it after my dad passed away. Yeah, and it's yeah, I thought I would show it to you. And I thought, oh, yeah. Yeah, the old Neighbours. And, yeah, there's some hilarious stuff. There's pictures of me and, like, Paul Keane and, yeah.
Amazing.
And, Mark, and yeah, it's really it's funny.
It's like a big,
it's funny, and it's funny that, you know, here we are 30 years later doing it all again,
and you're still there, although you were back very, very briefly, weren't you, for 2005? You were there filming.
Oh yes, I did a scene walking along the Thames.
Living in Ramsey Street was an absolute cack. I suppose some of my best fun was working for that mood-swinging tyrant, Paul Robinson. God, I got under his skin. And I shouldn't have married Joe. Two dumb mistakes.
What do you remember of that? And how did that sort of even come about? Was it a surprise that that was
happening? I remember it being absolutely freezing.
You looked it.
Surprise, surprise. Yeah. Yeah, I think, yeah, I do. I look absolutely frozen. And it must have been in the middle of winter. And I was kind of surprised at the text, if you know what I mean. When, I mean, I remember, you know, do you want to be involved in the Neighbours, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, oh, yeah, yeah, that'd be fun sort of thing. And I didn't really know how it was going to come about. And I knew that they were coming over here to see different people. And, yeah, and so it was... It was all about the fact that Joe and Melanie had split up, and that, you know, that was she'd made a terrible mistake being with Joe, and that
there was no holding back on that, was there? Like that.
I know, it was really like, yeah. Anyway, that came as a bit of a shock to me, because I kind of thought they'd sailed off into the sunset together quite happily. Yeah.
I always like to think when I grew up watching that show, I was devastated.
That's what I you know, it's this naive optimism that we have, Joe.
It lets us down all of the time.
Well, apparently the writers had quite a different idea. And, you know, things go pear, you know, things, you know, drama's all about things going pear-shaped.
Things very rarely stay happy for the people. Do they?
Yeah, exactly. It's the happier you are, the more people will watch you fall apart.
Exactly. It's what we're there for. We're all masochists. So we've got about 5 minutes left. And obviously, there are so many sort of Melanie storylines that we could go through from your time on the show, but we just don't have the time to even touch on them. But what are some of sort of the things that you look back on as the most fondest from that original stint of the show? So what are your
Really enjoying hanging around with the older actors like Anne Hattie and, you know, Anne Charleston and Ian Smith, and just them, just laughing with them.
Come on, hurry up.
All right, all right. Coming as fast as I can. Now, what's the idea of ordering me down like that? Wasn't doing any harm.
It's a matter of opinion. People around here don't like being spied on.
But I wasn't spying on anyone. I was photographing a bird.
Oh, yes, I don't know about the bird you were photographing.
But who could believe that you'd be the peeping Tom, Harold? Eddie was right, you know. He said that it was the quiet ones that were always the worst.
Yeah, so they say.
Melanie, don't be ridiculous.
Don't harass the young lady. Now, if you'd like to accompany us to the station, we'll file the complaint.
What for? You're not arresting me, are you?
That all depends on what you have to say for yourself, and believe me, it better be a little more convincing than what you've said so far.
And I remember there was some scenes I did with Ian Smith where he was supposed to teach me how to sing.
Yes, and I remember those.
Yeah.
Oh my, that we were just in hysterics because I was just trying to sing as off key. You know, you don't get the opportunity to do that sort of thing very often.
Take heart of grace, my steps retrace. Oh, wandering one, take remember.
Sorry, Mr. B. Just couldn't help myself.
Yes. Can you sing as off key as, and I just, the, you know, I'm the wrong person to ask that of, and we all just ended up in absolute, you know, fits of snorting snot, you know, of laughter and sort of like feeling sick in the stomach from our ribs going to break. And Ian Smith was someone who just, you know, once he started giggling, it was just, you know, that was it. He just couldn't get through things. He was hilarious.
Yes, he's very not like Harold, is he, in real life at all?
Oh, no. No, God, no. He's really cool guy, Smithy. He was always a really cool guy and funny, naughty funny, you know, not sort of funny. Like, he was, like, cutting edge funny. He's good. He's a good bloke.
Always wanted to speak to her. I've met Anne Charleston, spoken to her, but never Ian Smith yet. So he's on my list to try and get hold of at some point at all. We always ask as well about Anna Haddie because obviously we can't talk to Anna Haddie, which is really upsetting. But sort of you mentioned you work with her quite a lot. You got any kind of memories or stories you can share about Anne? Because everybody always seems
Look, she used to always tell me. I used to love it because Anne would tell me stories about what it was like, you know, in the 50s making, like, radio plays at the ABC with, you know, all of these old Australian actors that, you know. And I just used to love listening to her and how much she, you know, loved the art and loved the whole thing. And she just loved being an actor. And, you know, and her husband, James, were just so absolutely in love with each other. They were just so ridiculously adorable to be around. She was just gorgeous. She was just such a lady in every sort of sense of the word. And yet she was terribly naughty as well, but never sort of without dignity, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, it's a rare feat to be able to pull that off, isn't it? Sort of keep the dignity.
Oh, look, she had that really classy sort of thing going on, Hattie. And I could just sit there and listen to her tell me stories about, you know.
That's what everybody says, that she was such a good storyteller.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And she, you know, she was really good. And it made you feel, you know, sort of made you feel really special when she liked you, if you know what I mean, because she was very sort of, you know,
just very professional as well, wasn't she? Like, she wouldn't stand forward. It's another thing we hear quite a lot about.
Yeah.
Again, thank you so much. It's so good having you back on the show again.
Thank you.
Yay, such a pleasure to be back. So lovely. I'm so very, very grateful and so happy that people in the UK are enjoying Mel's return. Buckle up, though. It's going to get bumpy between, you know.
Good.
It'll be good to watch, but it's going to get bumpy.